Company, halt! Detail, right face. Detail, post colors. Detail, present arms. Order arms.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he heard me. He delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, saved him out of all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and delivereth them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. I come to thank Almighty God for his grace and mercy and blessing on our country and Brookhaven Township. I thank God for blessing all families, especially black families, as we celebrate Black History Month on this 30th annual Black History Night celebration. I'm encouraged by the blessings that Almighty God has bestowed on our nation as we move forward together to promote the contributions black people have made to the United States of America. We are pleased by the contributions of all Americans, but today we open this 30th annual celebration to thank God for seeing us through over 400 years from being removed from our ancestral homes to a new land, a prosperous land, a blessed land that is as much ours as it is anyone else's except the American Indians. We ask for wisdom, strength, love, cooperation, and support for all those in authority and for all those who will participate in this 30th Black History Celebration. Finally, we thank Almighty God for promoting Councilwoman Cartwright to Supreme Court Justice and legislative aide Jennifer L. Martin, Esquire, the former chairperson of the Brookhaven Black History Commission, as Judge Cartwright's assistant. We thank our town supervisor and the town council for their cooperation in helping us to keep this annual celebration ongoing. We thank Almighty God for blessing us all, especially the United States of America. Each and every one of you that hears this prayer, we bless you. We pray Almighty God's richest blessings for you, and we pray in the matchless name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen.
At this time, I would invite the Brookhaven NAACP to please come forward. They will lead us in Lift Every Voice and Sing. And for those of you that may not be familiar with Lift Every Voice and Sing, it was written in the 1900s by James Weldon Johnson, and it was originally written to be a poem as part of the birthday celebration for Abraham Lincoln, and it was eventually put to music by James Johnson's brother. And it eventually became what is now known as the Negro or the Black National Anthem. So at this time, we would invite you to stand, and the NAACP will lead us, and we invite you to join in, lift every voice, and sing.
Rise! Hi, I'm Brookhaven Town Supervisor Ed Romaine. Welcome to Brookhaven Town's Black History Night 2021. Because of COVID-19 pandemic, we are doing this virtually. But it is important that we acknowledge the contributions that African Americans have made to the history of the town, our country, our state, and our nation. I would like to thank our Black History Commission and its members, including its new chairperson, Dr. Corinne Graham, our vice chairperson, Leah Jefferson, and the members, Janet Batten, Miles Green, Dr. Georgette Greer-Key, Clayton Hudson, Charlotte Presley, Lorraine Richardson McCray, and Tracy Todd Hunter. Over the years, the Black History Commission has organized the town's Black History Month celebration, honored the life of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King with a luncheon every year, and organized our annual Juneteenth celebration and a host of other key events. Thank you for your service. Tonight we honor students from high schools throughout the town of Brookhaven who have achieved a grade point average of 90% or above. These are the future leaders of our country. And in the words of Dr. King, a country that hopefully will judge people not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. A country that celebrates its multiracial and its multicultural past. A country whose motto is E Pluribus Unum, which means out of many, one. These are outstanding people who will progress to the next level of education. They will face many challenges on the road to success. It is my hope and all of our hopes that this society treats them and all of us equally and fairly and equitably. In Centereach, we find contributions from the African American community. Down the street from where I live, the town has preserved the Mary E. Bell House, built in 1872 by an African American family that actually got there in the 1840s. It reflects the history of Long Island's African American community. The home was threatened with demolition in 2009 before the town of Brookhaven took ownership. The Mary E. Bell House is another treasured landmark that is now on the National Register of Historic Places. It tells a story about our community and the people who have called it home. There's also the Bethel AME Zion Church in Setauket, a historic landmark that has been actively serving the community for over 170 years. Then there is the community of Gordon Heights that had its beginning in the late 1920s when developer Louis Fife sold land for as low as $10 down and $10 monthly. The community was named after Pop Gordon, a man who personally owned most of the land. 74 years later, the community, its fire department, its civic association, and its chamber of commerce is still going strong. Each hamlet in Brookhaven has a history. If we look closely, we find people of color who've contributed and who are part of that community. It is my honor to welcome you to this year's virtual Town of Brookhaven Black History Night 2021. I hope you enjoy the program.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today at our Town of Brookhaven Black History Month 30th Annual Celebration. I am Dr. Corinne Graham, Chair of the Town of Brookhaven Black History Commission. Thanks to our Supervisor Ed Romaine, our elected officials, community supporters, and our hardworking and dedicated Black History Commission members, who work tirelessly to bring these wonderful events to celebrate and share our rich cultures. Leah Jefferson, Tracy Todd Hunter, Janet Batten, Miles Green, Clayton Hudson, Dr. Georgette Greer-Key, Lorraine Richardson McCray, and Charlotte Presley. I would be remiss not to say thank you to Justice Valerie Cartwright and our outgoing chair, Jennifer Martin, for all their wonderful work and support to our town's Black History Commission. I wish them continued success. As always, We use this opportunity to celebrate our students and the fantastic work they have done. In a time where there have been surmountable challenges, let's give extra cheers for a job well done to our student honorees. This year's Black History Month theme is the Black Family, Representation, Identity, and Diversity. This would take a lifetime to talk about, and I'm so excited we have a wonderful presentation to share with you. But what a year to talk about the Black family. What a year that showcased our faith, passion, resilience, sense of family, love, and community. We have overcome so many, many burdens, wrongs, and setbacks, and still we rise and make history. We still have a long way to go for our Black family, and we continue onwards in the footsteps of some of our greats, Carter G. Woodson, Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Shirley Chisholm, and John Lewis, and many others who have paved the way and continue to pave the way to achieve social justice and equity for our Black families. Thank you again for joining this year's program, and we look forward to seeing you at our upcoming 2021 events, such as Juneteenth and movie nights. Please contact us at TOB, Black History Commission, at brookhavenny.gov. Thank you again for joining us, and have a wonderful day.
Hi, I'm Lieutenant Governor Kathy Hochul. I want to take a moment to share some reflections on Black History Month. From social justice and immigrants' rights to suffrage and human rights, Black History Month embodies both the struggle and the strength of the past. But more than just pausing every February to honor those who fought for equality and justice, we must actively carry on the work that began in many ways in our own state. Yes, New York is where it happened. It's where the Niagara Movement, which later became the NAACP, was launched. It's where abolitionists and suffragists, Sojourner Truth, was born. It's where Harriet Tubman made her home for half a century and was relentless in her fight for equality. It's where Frederick Douglass used his exceptional oratory skills to win support for the cause of freedom. It's where Dr. Martin Luther King spoke of his reaffirmed belief in nonviolence after a failed assassination attempt on his life. And it's where Shirley Chisholm broke gender and racial barriers in her quest for the presidency. The legacy of transformational activism lies in our state and is an enormous point of pride for all New Yorkers. But this pride in our past does not blind us to the failures of the present. We still see the ugliness of racial discrimination and injustice. We still see more Black women dying in childbirth. We still see more Black patients dying from COVID. And we still see more Black men dying with the knee of a police officer on their neck. We just ended a year of tremendous pain for Black Americans. The dual trauma of COVID-19, which disproportionately impacted people of color, and simultaneously the trauma of viewing the gut-wrenching televised images of murders of innocent Black men like George Floyd and the other tragic stories of Black lives senselessly revealed during the Black Lives Matter protest across America. These revelations, long known in communities of color, shocked the conscience of white Americans who could no longer close their eyes to the harsh realities captured on video. They are finally waking up to the reality of living in two Americas, one Black and one white. The outrage we see in response to racism and discrimination is the start of a re-energized movement. People of all backgrounds coming together to use their voices to demand change. This national uprising for racial justice puts a bright spotlight on the very injustices Black people have suffered and faced throughout history. Instead of denying these parts of our history, we must vow to acknowledge it and ensure that it will never, ever happen again. Last summer, Governor Cuomo launched a statewide effort to expose and eradicate the systemic racism roiling beneath our criminal justice system and force police departments and communities to work together toward a common plan. Those plans are due next month. Meanwhile, we believe that justice demands that Black and Brown communities hardest hit by the pandemic must be among the first communities to receive life-saving vaccines as guided by our health equity task force all across the state. Yes, I think my former colleague in Congress, the great John Lewis, is right when he says, we must find a way to get in the way. New Yorkers are doing just that. As we celebrate Black history, we also look to the future and whether generations together in the future will agree that Dr. Martin Luther King, what he said was that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it does bend toward justice. Whether or not that becomes the reality of the future is no longer up to Dr. King. It's up to all of us. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Councilwoman Jane Bonner. Welcome to the Town of Brookhaven's 2021 Black History Month virtual event. It is said that Black History Month is a time that we recognize the achievements by African Americans and the central role that they play in U.S. history. Today we honor the Black family and the role it plays as young and old, keep their eyes on the prize, and navigate a long and winding road through life. To the students who are being honored today, I leave you with these words from Marion Wright Edelman, founder and president emerita of the Children's Defense Fund, who said, "Education is for improving the lives of others and for leaving your community and world better than you found it. If you follow these words and stay true to yourself, you will make the world a better place to live." Thank you and enjoy the rest of the program.
No difference what you're going through. You're gonna make it. God's gonna see you through. Hold your head up. Put a smile on your face. This is another test, and He won't last always. So get ready.
You can have it.
You
Hi, I'm Councilman Kevin LaValle, and I'm proud to be a part of the Town of Brookhaven's 2021 Black History Month virtual event. I welcome everyone watching and those taking part in our celebration of the Black family. As we face the challenges of the pandemic, I am reminded of the great poet and civil rights leader, Maya Angelou, who said, "I sustain myself with the love of family." Only 8 words, but so powerful and universal. During times like these, we turn to our families for support and guidance to see us through, and that love is what brings us together for this great event. I'd like to leave the students who we honor today with something special to remember. In 1948, a 20-year-old college student, not much older than all of you, said, "Intelligence plus character, that is the goal of true education." The speaker was Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and his words still ring true over 70 years later and continue to inspire students worldwide. Good luck to you all, and thank you for helping to make this event such a great success.
I'm sitting here today on the front porch of the Mary E. Bell House. A number of years ago, I noticed a tree hit the roof, and I was concerned about the safety of the house. I then notified the Preservation League. The Preservation League sent 2 of their field reps here, Roberta Lane and Brent Legg, and they clarified that the house did qualify for state register status. They notified the New York State Parks. The New York State Parks then notified Brookhaven Town that this house had significant history embedded in it for generations, connecting the Black community here in Center Moriches.
Thank you for joining us for our annual Town of Brookhaven Juneteenth celebration. My name is Valerie Cartwright, and I am the Town Council Liaison to the Black History Commission. Now that you've learned some insightful information and have had an opportunity to see the historic Mary Bell House, we're gonna take you inside so that we can learn a little bit more about the historic cooking of African American church suppers.
Today we're gonna be featuring some recipes dating back to 1848, fried chicken and some sweet potato pie that was a favorite of Mary Bell's.
We will also be talking about traditional Juneteenth food that would have been eaten at that time. So let's get started.
You got it. All right, so would you like to start with the chicken? This recipe comes from Dr. Alice Ross's cookbook for the celebration of Brookhaven's history of 350th anniversary.
This is the only item that you'll see that will be marred, because we're very careful to make sure that we're using
traditional foods.
Yes. So now this is the chicken that we will place in. It's important, Diane, to tell them what kind of oil we're frying this chicken in.
So the oil that we're using today in the cast iron stove is lard. Lard is a pig fat that has been rendered where all the meat material has been taken out of it. Do you hear the sizzling? That's the oil or the lard dancing. The chicken is put in the lard and it will stay there for about 20 minutes. We'll rotate it so it gets a golden brown.
And the reason why we're actually doing fried chicken today is because the Mary E. Bell House and the woman was very important to the local church here as one of the founders, and her generations of her ancestors were still involved. The church is still here today, and it's very important to keep that legacy going.
We're taking the chicken off now, and we're putting it on newspaper. Newspaper was not wasted. It was used to absorb the lard drippings. For those of you who have never made a crust from scratch, this is 2 cups of flour with some Crisco and or butter and a little bit of water. What you do is then you take some flour so it doesn't stick, you cool your dough, and you can roll it out into a wonderful circle. And I did learn that there was a sweet potato farm in Centereach in Selden.
So these were boiled beforehand, and we're just going to open up and scoop it out. Tell them what we also have. We have some milk in here, the spices and seasonings.
There's evaporated milk. There's mace, nutmeg, and cinnamon. Also, we're going to be adding one stick of butter to that mixture. And then Georgette is going to use a masher, and she's going to mash it all together. It gets poured into the crust and then put into the stove.
So now I'm just making sure that we have some little, a little bit of orange juice in there. That's always the little extra touch that you need. And we're going to have a little zest as well.
So here we have the sweet potato pie.
So just talking about these traditions, it just makes you think about just slowing down a little bit, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's what's really perfect about Juneteenth. This year, unfortunately, we can't have our gathering, but talking about these recipes bring you back to what it's really about.
Exactly.
Family, being together, talking about traditions, your background and your family, so that we don't forget, we always remember who we are, where we came from, and how much further we have to go.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Hi, Councilman Michael Loguercio here, and welcome everyone to the 30th Annual Black History Month celebration. I'm always honored to be a part of this evening when we recognize the culture, history, and contributions of Black Americans in all our communities. Family is so important to us all, and those traditions that we carry on from generation to generation is just as invaluable. Keeping these bonds of multi-generational influences is key to the strength of a family and offers firsthand knowledge and experiences to our youth. Congratulations to all the honorees on their achievements and recognition this evening, and thank you for your contributions and making a difference right here in the town of Brookhaven.
Just a piece of property, what we hold on through.
Our keynote today is Sheriff Dr. Errol Toulon, Jr. Sheriff Toulon, Jr. became Suffolk County, New York's 67th sheriff and the county's first African-American to be elected to a non-judicial countywide office. As Suffolk's highest-ranking law enforcement official, he is working to serve and protect the county's 1.5 million residents through innovative programs and to reduce crime and recidivism, and by implementing sound fiscal policies. Sheriff Toulon has more than 30 years of criminal justice experience, heavily centered upon corrections, intelligence, and combating gang violence. Prior to serving as Suffolk County Sheriff, Errol worked for 22 years as a uniform member of service with the New York City Department of Correction. In July of 2014, he was named Deputy Commissioner of Operations for the New York City Department of Correction. Sheriff Toulon is certified through the Department of Homeland Security in Emergency Planning, Radiological Emergency Management, Incident Response to Terrorist Bombing, WMD Threat and Risk Assessment, and State Disaster Management. In addition, he is certified to teach courses in Weapons of Mass Destruction Awareness, National Incident Management Systems, Domestic Terrorism and Hate Crimes. He received his master's degree in Business Administration and doctorate in Educational Administration from Dowling College, an advanced certificate in Homeland Security Management from Long Island University. And he attended leadership courses at the JFK School of Government at Harvard University.
Hi, I'm Dr. Errol Toulon, Jr., and I'd like to welcome everyone to the Town of Brookhaven's 30th Annual Black History Month celebration. I would especially like to thank Brookhaven Town Supervisor Ed Romaine and former Town Councilwoman Valerie Cartwright for inviting me to speak and be the keynote speaker today. This year's theme, The Black Family, Representation, Identity, and Diversity, covers many aspects of my personal life. I grew up in the South Bronx. My father was a warden who worked on Rikers Island for 36 years, and my mother worked for the Board of Education for over 30 years as a school secretary. I watched not only my parents go to work every single day and perform their jobs to the best of their ability, but they were both adult learners. Later on in life, they both decided to go back to college, my father obtaining two master's degrees and my mother obtaining her bachelor's degree. And many times my brother and I would accompany our mother to school, and we would sit outside her classroom doing our homework while she was inside her classroom doing her schoolwork. And so we saw the dedication and the meaning of what college education really is. I was very fortunate to go to very good schools in the South Bronx during that time, and also was able to become the bat boy for the New York Yankees during the 1979 and 80 season. So now most of you are trying to guess my age as you hear this. After I graduated from high school, I went on to a community college. I tell many students today that I wasn't the greatest student. I wasn't an A student when I was in high school, but I did the best I could. And so I went to a community college and got my associate's degree. I then went on and followed in my father's footsteps and became a New York City correction officer, where over 22 years, I had a really great experience of learning many different things. The unfortunate thing during my period with the New York City Department of Correction was that it was during the height of the crack cocaine epidemic. And at one point, we had over 25,000 individuals in our custody in New York City. One of the things that my father had taught me at a very young age was the fact that rehabilitation was really his job as a young correction officer. And that mindset stuck with me as I became a New York City correction officer, and even more so when I became the sheriff of Suffolk County. My parents instilled great values of hard work, dedication, and perseverance, and I'm happy to say that in October of this year, they'll be married 60 years, and a true testament to that sentiment that they've instilled in me. Eventually, I moved out, got married, had two sons, and my wife and I moved out to Lake Grove here in Suffolk County which was over 30 years ago right here in Brookhaven. And so I'm very proud to be speaking today, being a Brookhaven resident. And I found that the town was very opening. I learned a lot about what happens here in Suffolk County by being a Brookhaven resident. And I think more importantly, you know, especially as I evolved into the role of sheriff, I got to understand the various issues that many of our constituents, you know, are facing today. You know, even more in these troubled times of dealing with COVID, social unrest, and also financial, economic issues that are occurring in some of our households. It's a very challenging time, especially for those that are African Americans. It is very difficult sometimes to feel that the playing field is level. I felt like I needed to receive my doctorate or pursue my doctorate in education because I feel that I needed to compete, and I need to compete at a very high level. You know, some individuals may not have that opportunity, and so I encourage many students, because I've been in 1 to 2 schools per week prior to COVID occurring, to try and find out what are the issues that they're faced with. The drugs, the alcohol, the gang issues, the vaping issues, many of the issues that our young men and women are faced with in high schools that we probably never thought at during my generation. And you know, when you think about the African American communities, what are they faced with? You know, challenging times. Most households in Suffolk County and throughout our nation are faced with mental health issues, substance abuse issues, economic issues, domestic violence in the household. And so how do we help these men and women overcome the battles that they're facing, both externally and internally? Because sometimes you feel like when you walk around, just because of the color of your skin, you may be judged a certain way. And you know, the most important thing for every person that's listening to me today is to go out, live your life, be the person that you are, and achieve everything that you want to achieve. You know, sometimes things are not going to come your way. I'm a 2-time cancer survivor. I lost my first wife after 29 years, and still somehow I needed to persevere. And trust me, physically battling cancer, especially pancreatic cancer, which was my second battle, is extremely difficult. And there were many times when I felt like I did not want to go on. I went back as a deputy commissioner. I retired after 22 years with the New York City Department of Correction because of my battle with pancreatic cancer, and returned back 10 years later as the deputy commissioner of operations. And in 2017, January, I was asked to resign because I would not lie and fudge numbers for the mayor of New York and City Hall. And so for an entire year in 2017, I was unemployed. Here I had a doctorate in education. I was a deputy commissioner of operations for one of the largest penal institutions in the United States and could not find a job. I understand the plight of what many people are going through. I don't take my position lightly, and I do think that in my position and other elected officials, not only should we seek to help individuals who are going through hard times, but look at the circumstances that they're faced with. Look at the issues. We try to understand here in the sheriff's office what are those adverse childhood effects that occurred in an individual's life that led them to some criminogenic behavior. And so we've created many rehabilitation programs to try and work and assist them so that when they return back to our communities, they're more successful than when they came here. We don't want to use the time here in the sheriff's office when they're incarcerated as idle time where they're trying to figure it out by themselves. We want to try and assist those men and women, because 85% of them will be returning back to our community. They will be seated in a movie theater when movie theaters are open. They will be in the supermarkets in front of you or behind you. So why not give them that opportunity to try and help? Many African Americans are feeling a lot of discomfort of what's going on throughout our country today. They're finding great difficulty in finding jobs. They feel that there's disparate treatment amongst them. And all I can say is just continue to fight the fight. We have to continue to actually show our worth, our value, and not let anyone put any limitations on what we want to do and what we want to achieve. All families, whether they're here in Suffolk County or throughout our United States, are families that want to try and take care of themselves, do the best that they can. And I think those that may be doing a little better during a particular time should assist them, should try and work with them. It's very, very important. I know what it's like to have illnesses. I know what it's like to lose a loved one. I know what it's like to be unemployed and almost losing their house. And so I encourage all of you to try and uplift each other. Try and pick each other up. Try to give encouraging words and try not to be disparaging. I think now is the best time that we can actually extend our hand and try and pick someone up so that they don't fall prey to some of the vices that occur throughout our society. Again, I want to thank the town of Brookhaven, Supervisor Ed Romaine, former Councilwoman Valerie Cartwright, and the entire town board of Brookhaven for inviting me to speak today. God bless you and God bless America.
I'm Councilman Neil Foley, and welcome to the virtual Black History Month celebration in the town of Brookhaven. I'm happy to join my fellow town board members in thanking the Black History Commission and all the people who made this event a reality. The Black family who we honor today has played a vital role in the history of our town and continues to be a guiding force into the future. To all the students who we honor today, as you recognize and appreciate the contributions that African Americans have made to our country, please remember this quote by the late, great Congressman and civil rights leader John Lewis, who stood arm in arm with Martin Luther King Jr. at the 1963 March on Washington. He said, "When you see something that is not right, not fair, not just, you have to speak up. You have to say something. You have to do something. Follow his lead and you help to build a better future for the generations to come. Thank you."
Do what I can, don't put the blame on me. Don't Don't put your blame on me.
Our honoree is Professor Zebulon Miletsky. Professor Miletsky is an Associate Professor of Africana Studies and History at Stony Brook University. Professor Miletsky is also a TEDx speaker, columnist at BK Reader, 2019 Academic Program Committee Chair and Executive Council Member, Class of 2022, at Association for the Study of African American Life and Honor, and author of Before Busing, Boston's Long Freedom Struggle in the Cradle of Liberty.
Greetings. My name is Dr. Zebulon Miletsky. I'm an associate professor of Africana Studies and History at Stony Brook University, and I am thrilled to be here today and to be serving as the honoree for the town of Brookhaven's Black History Month celebration. I'm indebted to a number of people involved with the town, especially Valerie Cartwright, who has been in my corner for many years, and so happy for you and your new position, and wishing you all the best, and everybody from the wonderful town of Brookhaven. I am pleased to be associated with this effort and with this event. As someone who has worked with the town of Brookhaven over the years in various capacities, the Black History Month celebration and this year's theme, the Black Family, Representation, Identity, and Diversity, as defined by the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, which sets the yearly Black History theme, an organization I'm pleased to also work with and be a part of. It's a real pleasure to have a chance to reflect on this very important theme as we find ourselves in this time in a new year, looking at various ideas and issues that affect the African American community at large, and particularly we find that the Black family becomes critically important, not only to understand our journey as a people, but also as a way to gauge progress. How much progress have we made since the civil rights movement and since the social movements, which had an effect on debates around the Black family, till today? And we're looking at various issues confronting our communities that remind us how important the family is. And so these remarks come from a talk that I have been working on, and a lecture that I'm going to be giving at the Brentwood Public Library in February on Black History Month, and all are invited and welcome. And the title is The Black Family, Controversial Terrain in American Scholarship. It is the beginning of the year of our Lord, 1963. I see a young Negro boy. He is sitting on a stoop in front of a vermin-infested apartment house in Harlem. The stench of garbage is in the halls. The drunks, the jobless, the junkies are shadow figures of his everyday world. The boy goes to a school attended mostly by Negro students with a scattering of Puerto Ricans. His father is one of the jobless. His mother is a sleep-in domestic working for a family on Long Island. I see a young Negro girl. She is sitting on the stoop of a rickety wooden one-family house in Birmingham. Some visitors would call it a shack. It needs paint badly, and the patched-up roof appears in danger of falling. Half a dozen small children in various stages of undress are scampering about the house. The girl is forced to play the role of their mother. She can no longer attend the all-Negro school in her neighborhood because her mother died only recently after a car accident. Neighbors say if the ambulance hadn't come so late to take her to the all-Negro hospital, the mother might still be alive. The girl's father is a porter in a downtown department store. He will always be a porter, for there are no promotions for the Negro in this store, where every counter serves him except the one that sells hot dogs and orange juice. This boy and this girl, separated by stretching miles, are wondering, why does misery constantly haunt the Negro? In some distant past, had their forebears done some tragic injury to the nation? And was the curse of punishment upon the black race? Had they shirked in their duty as patriots, betrayed their country, denied their national birthright? Had they refused to defend their land against a foreign foe? This was written by Dr. Martin Luther King in his classic, Why We Can't Wait, published in 1963. And the reason I decided to talk about that quote is because I think King captures perfectly not only the plight of the black family, but specifically the black family in New York and in the North. And I want to talk about black families who moved to Long Island and Queens in the 1970s in search of the American dream. That produced a great deal of white flight and blockbusting, real estate schemes, anger, racism. And what we see are families in search of the American dream, stretching the idea that was promised from the civil rights movement of an integrated society, one in which African Americans and whites could live in harmony. But as black folks begin to move into parts of Long Island, to Nassau County, into Queens, we see a great deal of backlash, a denial essentially of the promise of the American dream, the idea that African American families could live anywhere they chose. The other piece is to pick up on something called the Moynihan Report in 1965, which caused a great deal of controversy because it blamed poverty on the black family for absent fathers and characterized women-headed households as pathological, the so-called broken homes theory. The notorious Moynihan Report and debates about the black family in the 1960s and 70s are very important for us to consider. We also need to talk about the American dream, considering we just celebrated Martin Luther King's birthday and holiday. And we need him now. Remember his famous words, "I have a dream." Deeply rooted, though, in the American dream. Are we still living that dream, or is it a dream deferred? These are questions that I will be talking about in this talk on the black family. So as we approach the celebration of the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, or ASALA, as we call ourselves, national theme in 2021, it comes down to the black family as a controversial terrain in American scholarship, striking at the heart of so many taboo topics and issues in the black experience as a whole, including slavery, family separation during slavery, undercutting of black masculinity, unemployment and underemployment, respectability politics, and issues of class, which were missing in Daniel Patrick Moynihan's analysis and report, which was actually titled "The Negro Family, A Case for National Action," and a host of other issues that we'll tackle together. And that talk will take place on February 19th from 5 to 6 p.m., and it will be happening virtually through the Brentwood Public Library, and you can register for the talk on their site. I invite you to make it. I hope you can make it. And in the meantime, I just want to thank again the town of Brookhaven for this wonderful, wonderful honor. It means so much to me and my family. And I thank all of you, and I look forward to continuing to work with the town in 2021. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brookhaven Town Councilman Dan Panico, and I'm proud to welcome you to our 2021 Black History Celebration in the town of Brookhaven. It's one of the special things we do every year, and usually we get together in our auditorium and we honor those students who are academic achievers, and rightfully so, because Black history is part of Brookhaven's history and part of American history. Everyone is proud of their heritage, and it's great that we set aside some time to honor those students, honor the community, and honor the history that African Americans and all people of color have made, not only to this town, but to this country. I welcome you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Clayton Hudson, and as a member of the Town of Brookhaven Black History Commission, I would like to welcome you to tonight's Black History Celebration. Tonight, we are celebrating graduating high school seniors who have made outstanding academic achievements over the past 3.5 years of their high school career. This has been especially challenging over the past year because of COVID, which has caused many high school closings. But we must celebrate them as they have overcome these challenges. Again, let's celebrate them. Thank you.
Good evening, and welcome to the 30th Annual Black History Celebration. Tonight, we honor our class of 2021. As you know, with COVID, it's been a very trying task to do distant learning, yet our students have achieved that goal. So we just want to thank them and congratulate them for all their wonderful attributes.
My name is Nora Hunt, and I'm looking to attend Baruch College or St. John's University in order to obtain a bachelor's degree in communication arts.
Hello, my name is Michael Paredes. I am attending Bellport High School, and I will be majoring in biomedical engineering.
My name is Cameron Kerr-Smith, and I'm planning on going for a degree in game development and design.
My name is Dream Smith. After graduation, I plan to attend art school, where I will study illustration.
My name is Delilah Tinsley, and after graduating, I am hoping to attend a four-year college and get my bachelor's in psychology. And then after that, I am looking to go to medical school to become a psychiatrist. Right now, I really don't have a set college I want to go to, but one of my top choices is Binghamton.
Hi, my name is Naya Pemberton. After graduation, I will attend a four-year institution where I plan to study communications.
My name is Jaden Keeley. I attend Center Moriches High School. After graduation, I am currently undecided as to where I will attend, but I plan on majoring in communications.
Hi, my name is Isabella Reed. My junior year, I committed to play NCAA Division I women's lacrosse for Monmouth University. I will be majoring in health studies for the Physician's Assistant Program track. I am honored to be nominated for the Town of Brookhaven Black History Commission for the Academic Achievement of Excellence Award. Thank you.
My name is Jada Hodge from Centereach High School. After graduation, I plan on majoring in biology and pursuing a career as a physician assistant.
Hello, my name is Brittany Hunt from Centereach High School. The colleges I'm looking to attend are Nyack College, the King's College, Pace University, St. John's University, the New School, Marymount Manhattan College, and Metropolitan College of New York, and plan on majoring in biology.
My name is Adelise Hunt from Centereach High School. After graduation, I'll be attending University at Albany and plan on studying business.
My name is Courtney Hunt from Centereach High School, and I'm looking to attend Brooklyn College, Hunter College, and University at Buffalo. and I plan on studying biological sciences.
Hi, my name is Sophie Germain, and I am from Centereach High School. After graduation, I plan on attending St. John's University, where I'll be studying legal studies to become a lawyer.
Hello, my name is Emily Jones. I go to Centereach High School. I plan on attending Howard University, and I want to pursue a career in fashion design.
My name is Molly Otazi from Centereach High School. I plan on going to Plattsburgh University to pursue a degree in nursing.
My name is Jaden Seaman from Centereach High School. I do not know what college I plan on attending yet, but I do plan on pursuing a major in business and minoring in entrepreneurship.
Isabel Lewis, and after high school, I plan to attend a university that has vast curriculums in the sciences, such as Johns Hopkins or Stony Brook, and major in either biology, psychology, or neuroscience.
Hi, my name is Imani Studdard. I plan to go to Stony Brook University and major in health science, and thank you for recognizing me on this celebration of Black History.
My name is Caitlin Dixon. I will be attending Hushin College in Studio in Los Angeles. I will be majoring in the BFA Commercial Dance Program in hopes of becoming a professional dancer and choreographer.
Hello, I'm Chaslyn Beard, and I'm currently a senior at Longwood High School. I intend on majoring in forensic psychology at John Jay College of Criminal Justice.
My name is Aaliyah McLean. I'm planning to attend Parsons, the School of Design in Manhattan, majoring in fashion design.
Hello, my name is Brianna Manderson. I go to Longwood High School. I intend on being a biology major at Pace University, and in the future, I want to be an optometrist.
My name is Victoria Aristodi. I plan to attend Manhattan College to study civil engineering.
Hi, my name is Amanda Rakatoravuni. I'm planning to major in computer science in college, and as of now, I have not been accepted. But my top three choices would be Columbia University, Carnegie Mellon University, and Boston University.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you and your families are all doing well tonight. My name is Talia Neal, and I am a senior at Longwood High School taking honors and AP courses. I am so incredibly honored to have been chosen for this celebration of Black History. My career plans have changed so many times throughout my life. From dentistry, because I've always loved getting my teeth cleaned, cosmetology, because I love when people feel beautiful inside and out, especially through beauty and self-love, to business and finance, because I've read books and listened to podcasts where people become debt-free and on their way to millionaire status. I really loved the idea of helping more people achieve financial freedom. I've always enjoyed science, and I loved chemistry in school and college. Even though we were in quarantine, because I had a great teacher. Through these challenging times, I realized that while I don't want to be a doctor at a hospital, I still want to be able to help people. And so, in September, I will be beginning my journey to a degree in pharmaceutical science and pharmacy at Suffolk Community College for 2 years. I chose to begin my higher learning at Suffolk because I am already enrolled in their early college program. One class each semester, 3 a year, starting from the summer after my sophomore year. I already have more than a dozen credits, and these classes really helped me make my decision to major in pharmaceutical science and pharmacy. After Suffolk, I will be transferring to the University of New Mexico to continue my degree. I also plan to minor in French while attending Suffolk and the University of New Mexico. Thank you for helping to honor and celebrate the achievements of Black scholars. Have a great night and enjoy the rest of the celebration of Black History Month.
Hello, my name is Trinity Miller, and I am looking to go into the career of neuropsychology. And my top three colleges are Princeton University, Columbia University, and Binghamton University. Thank you again so much for this opportunity and award.
Hi, my name is Amira Wells. In my future, a college that I would like to attend would either have to be North Carolina A&T University or Jacksonville State University. From there, I would like to achieve my bachelor's degree in majoring in biology. I will then go on to medical school. And after medical school, I would go to get my residency and be able to specialize in obstetrics and gynecology.
Hi, my name is Angeline Bailey. I'm a senior at Longwood High School. I am going to continue my plans at Newport University, where I plan to major in bio and continue playing basketball, as well as achieving my dreams of being a veterinarian and shadowing. My high school experience has been crazy so far, especially with COVID. I haven't had a prom, junior prom, or senior prom now, and things are just going to be a little crazy, but I'm going to keep pushing through, and I was so excited to see that I got this award, so go Lions and Hawks.
Hi, my name is Maya G. Francois. After graduating, I plan to go to Stony Brook and major in biology.
Hi, I'm Nina Marcus. I plan on going to Stony Brook, Farmingdale, or NYU to study registered nursing.
Hi, my name is Ayana Marsh, and I'm a senior at Longwood High School. I recently received an acceptance letter from Howard University, and I plan on attending there after I graduate. I have not decided on what my major will be, but I do have a love for math. It's an honor for me to receive this award. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Darius Freeman. I'm currently a senior at Longwood High School, and I plan to major in computer engineering at Hofstra University.
Hi, my name is Savannah Cole. I'm a senior at Longwood High School. I'm 17 years old, and I actually aspire to be a physician assistant. Now, with being a physician assistant, there's no like specific reason as to why I chose that field. One day I was really, really bored. It's probably maybe 1 or 2 years ago. And I was just looking, I knew I wanted to do something in the medical field. I knew that's what I wanted to do, from young even. And I was just browsing through, you know, a couple of the professions in the medical field, and I saw a lot of them. At first, my initial choice was anesthesiology, but, you know, like, my main priority right now is staying out of debt and, you know, looking ahead at medical school and, you know, books and study, and it's just equipment and for that profession in particular, like in specific, I was kind of like not really gearing towards that. So I chose to look into being a physician assistant. I read like, you know, the responsibilities of a physician assistant, what they do, you know, how long they work, what they're responsible for, like I said. So I saw those things and I was like, yes, this is definitely something that I want to do. Generally working in the healthcare setting will satisfy me, but this field in particular, this profession in particular, just intrigued me, and it compelled me to want to work towards that, and that has been my goal, and that will continue to be my goal until I get there. So here are the steps that I take to get to my goal. Right now, obviously, I'm a senior in high school, so I'm in the process of applying for colleges, and so far I have received some acceptances. So my pool of like choices of where I want to go is like quickly growing every single day as I'm getting all these acceptances back, so I'm really, really grateful for that. But the decision is hard. I kind of have an idea of what school I want to go to. I'm looking at the University of Buffalo, I'm looking at the University of Albany, I'm looking at all these schools, so those are kind of just two that I can pinpoint. Stony Brook, Binghamton, I'm looking at all those schools. That's kind of where I'm heading towards for college. And then in college, I do plan on getting my bachelor's or master's in any like health sciences or sciences program. So that includes chemistry, biochemistry, biology, psychology, stuff like that. For a couple of schools, I put kind of like different suggestions, like different majors. So for one, I put chemistry, for one, I put biochemistry, because I'm generally open to anything in the science field. So I finished my freshman year, I finished my sophomore year, I'm in my junior year of college, and I would then start to prepare applications for PA schools, prepare for interviews, just prepare for all that stuff, because that is like the starter of my career. Getting into a good pre-A program ensures that, you know, your career is steady, your career is set for the future. So that's kind of what my main priority would be by my junior year of college, getting those applications, getting them in, getting those acceptances, fingers crossed. I haven't necessarily looked into PA schools as of yet. I'm gonna kind of start maybe like my freshman year of college, maybe like a little bit towards the end of this year, I might start looking into some really good schools, taking down like notes, of, you know, where I might want to apply for the future. So now it's my senior year of college, and, you know, this is supposed to be my last year of college, you know, of kind of extending my education in that way. So that would kind of be, you know, the start of PA school, studying, and just working on getting in and out of PA school and getting my license and starting my career initially. So that would kind of be the steps that I would take to proceed from PA school. So after PA school, I do my 2 to 3 years, depending on the program. It's different for, you know, for certain programs. End of that program with, you know, fingers crossed, being successful and, you know, doing really well. Then finally taking the PANTS exam, which is the official physician assistant licensing exam. God's grace, I passed that and I can finally get my physician assistant license and start practicing in anywhere. Just taking care of patients and healthcare in general. It's just my main interest. It's something that I really like am passionate about. So I just want to say thank you for the awesome nomination. I am extremely proud, and it definitely proves my motto that hard work definitely pays off. Now that I'm thinking about it, you know, those stressful nights that I had back in 9th, 10th, 11th grade, they really paid off, because I am really proud of myself, and so are all my loved ones, my family members. Everyone's really proud of me, and I am proud of me, so that's really important too. So thank you guys so much again. Bye.
Hi, my name is Kyla Hayward, and I'm from Longwood High School. In the fall, I hope to attend an HBCU, either Morgan State or Howard University, to major in nursing.
Hi, my name is Teacher Control. I'm one of the nominees of the award we're receiving tonight, and I want to thank you for nominating me. I don't know who did, but I just want to thank you for nominating me, and I want to thank you for allowing me to receive this award. I really appreciate it. I am a senior at Longwood High School. It does not feel real. I'm almost done. I have a few more months left. I did not imagine my senior year would look like this, everything being from home. You know, I'm a distance learner. I'm not a hybrid learner, so everything I do is home, but just like kind of harder. But you know, I'm making the best of my situation. Who knows what the world's going to look like months from now. Hopefully it's better, but you know, I had a optimistic mindset, but I don't know about moving forward. But I'm getting used to you know, being distant. So college, I'm ready to tackle distance if I have to. I would really love to go to college, you know, be there, but who knows what's going to happen. But I want to double major in psychology or Spanish. But if they do have a pre-med program at the college I'm attending, I would like to do pre-medicine, because I want to be a child and adolescent psychiatrist. I would love to do like a foreign exchange student program. That's what I think that's what's called, like study abroad. I would love to go there and, you know, I want to be fluent in Spanish, because I don't want to limit myself to one language and one type of, you know, type of clientele. I want to be able to like expand my whole, you know, practice to everybody. So that's my hope for the future. You know, it seems like it's just going to be so quick, but it's such a process. But you know, it's achievable, and I'm very hopeful for the future. But you know, again, thank you so much. I appreciate it, and have a great night. Thank you.
My name is Chanel Nelson. After graduation, I will attend college and major in business and finance in order to start my own business in the future. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Precious Mizuvi, and after high school, I'm going to attend Stony Brook University, and I will be studying classes in computer programming and design, as well as taking math classes and business classes such as business and financing and statistics and calculus. And upon leaving college, I will be taking my actuarial exams, looking for internships to become an actuary, and on the side I will become a graphics designer, designing archetypes and character archetypes for shows and for children novels.
Hi, my name is Nia Marie Priestley. I would like to thank you for this opportunity. After graduation, I plan to attend Stony Brook University, where I plan to major in journalism.
Hello, my name is Sammy Colonna. I plan on attending Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland, to chase a doctorate's degree in biology and hopefully become a doctor. Thank you for granting this award upon me.
My name is Natasha Henderson. I plan on attending one of the following schools that I have submitted my applications to, which are St. Joseph's College in Patchogue, New York, SUNY Stony Brook, SUNY Oneonta, and SUNY Farmingdale. My undergraduate degree will be in biology, and my graduate degree will be in dentistry and orthodontistry.
Hi, my name is Kamaya Jones, and after graduation, I plan on attending Howard University, where I would like to study nursing and eventually become a registered nurse.
My name is Jane Elminder, and after graduation, I plan on studying psychology and neuroscience.
My name is Yetunde Olaturolabigi. After graduation, I will attend Vassar College, where I plan on studying biochemistry.
My name is Jane Paul. After graduation, I will attend Eastern Suffolk BOCES, where I will obtain my degree in nursing.
Hello, my name is JC Schneider, and after graduation, I plan on studying financial economics in college.
Hello, my name is Alex Stocco. After graduation, I plan on attending SUNY Fredonia, and I plan on majoring in music therapy.
My name is Jenica Kuoko. I go to Rocky Point High School. I have a GPA of 92, and I will be attending Drexel University for nursing in the fall. I'd like to thank the town of Brookhaven for acknowledging my academic achievements and including me in the 2021 Black History Night celebration.
My name is Kalea Hamilton. After graduation, I plan on attending the University of Scranton to double major in psychology and biology. After I graduate college, I plan on attending med school so I can be a psychiatrist.
Hello, my name is Brianna Nunez, and I currently attend Sachem's High School. If all goes well in March, this fall, I plan to pursue a joint major in computer and data science at New York University. Thank you.
My name is Corinne Desti. After graduation, I will attend LIU College located in Brooklyn, where I plan to study and obtain my bachelor's degree in occupational therapy.
My name is Alicia Kindle, and I'm a graduating senior from Sachem North High School. After graduating, I plan on obtaining my bachelor's degree from SUNY Newport with a major in communication sciences and disorders and a minor in deaf studies. After obtaining my bachelor's degree, I plan on pursuing my master's degree in speech language pathology. My love and interest for American Sign Language and my desire to help others have led me to discover this beautiful career path, and I look forward to every moment of it.
My name is Elisha Modesta. After graduation, I will attend Stony Brook University, where I will study criminal law.
Hello, my name is Abigail Bedell. After graduation, I plan on studying biology with the intention of attending the New York University, the George Washington University, or the University of Vermont, where I will obtain my master's degree.
My name is Raven Richardson. After graduation, I will attend Howard University, where I plan to study marketing communications.
Hi, my name is Sarah Crispin. I'll be attending LIU Post, where I'll be studying nursing.
Hello, my name is Armand Chancellor. After graduation, I plan on attending a four-year university and majoring in history.
Hello, my name is Chade Green, and I plan on studying neuroscience in college.
Hello, my name is Patricia Jean Baptiste. After I graduate, I want to study in pre-med or biological sciences. I already applied to several different colleges, including Stony Brook University, and I want to become a nurse practitioner. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jada Love, and I was accepted to Jacksonville University to study science in pre-nursing.
My name is Matthew Morrell. After graduation, I will attend Farmingdale State College, where I will study computer science before pursuing my career in law.
Hello, everyone. My name is Sania Pittner. I am currently a high school senior at William Floyd High School. After high school, I will be attending Emory University in Georgia. I plan to major in biology in hopes to pursue a career in the medical field. Thank you so much for having me.
Hello, I'm Jennifer Martin, the immediate past chair of the Town of Brookhaven Black History Commission. I would like to say it has been an honor and a privilege to serve as the chairperson of this distinguished committee for the last several years. Thank you to Town Supervisor Edward Romaine. Thank you to former Black History Commission liaison and former council member Valerie Cartwright. And thank you to all the members of the Brookhaven Town Board for your support of the Black History and its initiatives. I would like to also take a moment to give a very special thank you to each and every member of the commission. Our commission is made up of very talented, dedicated, committed members from across Brookhaven who are committed to the work of the commission and to educating and informing and celebrating Black history and culture within our town. So thank you. I would also like to take a moment to acknowledge and congratulate both our keynote speaker and our honoree, as well as all of the student honorees for this evening. Thank you to Sheriff Errol Toulon for your outstanding career and your trailblazing and pioneering work across Long Island, across Suffolk County, and across New York State. Thank you also to our honoree for this evening's program, Dr. Zebulon Miletsky, who was an early supporter of the Black History Commission and particularly a early supporter of the town's initial Juneteenth events and programs. And of course, this program would not be what it is without our student honorees. Congratulations for all of your hard work, your efforts, and your achievements, and wishing you the best of success in the future. Finally, to the community leaders, to the family and friends of the student honorees, and to all those who have joined us tonight, please continue to support the Black History Commission's efforts. We know that Brookhaven is a rich tapestry of cultures and communities, and we thank you for being here to celebrate the history and the legacy and the richness that is Black culture within our town. Thank you.
All hearts and minds are clear. May we close out in prayer. May the God of peace that brought forth from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.